station, this is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
We are ready for the event.
WNYC Radio, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is WNYC Radio. How do you hear me?
Hey, we have you loud and clear. How do you hear us?
Sounds great. So is Kjell Lindgren there? And Scott Kelly?
That's right. This is Kjell, and Scott's here as well.
All right, great. Thanks so much for spending time with us. We only have a few minutes, so I'll get right to it. How's your day going?
It's every day in space is it's a great day. We're busy today. We're doing a little bit of science, but mainly getting ready for the spacewalks that we have coming up next week.
And what will those spacewalks entail, Scott?
Well, the one next week, we refer to it as a space station upgrades. You know, some of the stuff is to improve the capability of the space station. We're going to run a bunch of cables that will allow for commercial crew vehicles to someday dock with the space station. But in addition to that, we're doing some repairs of some things. There's this alpha magnetic spectrometer that's having some cooling issues. We're going to put some insulating blankets on it. Chell's going to do that. And our robot arm has a sticky end effector that I'm going to lubricate. And we have some other activities in that spacewalk as well.
Those sticky end effectors, I hate those.
Yeah, they can be a problem.
How many blankets do you have to put on a spectrometer to warm it up?
Well, we've got one big blanket that I have to move around quite a bit in order to put in place, and then a smaller one that just goes on a side radiator. It's interesting because for both Scott and I, we'll be really on the top of the space station at this time while we're working on this. I'll be working on the AMS, and Scott will be working on another spare piece of equipment, actually taking the thermal blanket off of it. And we'll be really at the top of the station, so it should be a pretty magnificent view.
Well, I'm sure the view will be spectacular. You know, our motivation to talk with you, Kjell and Scott, is all about innovation and the kinds of innovation that enables the International Space Station to operate. But it sounds like a lot of what you do is very low-tech improvisation and kind of make do with what you have.
I don't know if that's the right way to, characterize it. It's a pretty high-tech laboratory we have here, and the systems that keep us alive are kind of state of the art. The environmental control system we have takes our urine, turns it into water. We turn that water into oxygen. We scrub carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, and from the water system that creates electricity, we take that hydrogen and the oxygen from the CO2, and then we make more water, and it's kind of this closed loop system that's pretty incredible. From a science perspective, the science facilities we have here are state of the art. They're very sophisticated. Whether it's life science experiments or basic physics, right here we have a combustion rack that every time I open the doors, I say we're going to be working on the time machine, because that's how sophisticated the thing looks. It's pretty incredible. So, sometimes we have to make do with what we have, but by and large, it's a pretty amazing, pretty sophisticated space station we got here.
Yeah, I wasn't criticizing in any way. It just, the way you're describing your experience up there, it's very human, this combination of state-of-the-art technology and state-of-the-art ingenuity to keep systems going. That's what humans have always done, and you just happen to be doing it in space.
Yeah, so certainly there's a lot of opportunity to be clever in how we keep things working. And, you know, a lot of that cleverness goes on the ground, and we just, you know, execute their brilliant plans they come up with. Maybe part of that, that's kind of what you're touching on a little bit. Also, you know, the fact that the environment we live in is pretty harsh, and, you know, it's kind of a, you know, pretty basic, you know, basic things we use to survive. You know, for instance, like we, you know, we don't take showers up here. So it's, you know, it's kind of a tough environment in that regard to live in, which is, you know, somewhat of a contrast, I guess, to, you know, living in this kind of pristine laboratory where, you know, you don't take a shower every day.
Describe the year mission, the one-year mission, and the extent to which studying how long you can take space travel and a weightless environment is going to bear on our ability to go to places like Mars.
Yeah, so our, you know, experience base, you know, with the space station and the current capability we have to collect the type of data we need to understand the effects on this environment, on our, you know, physiology over the long term, is not that great. You know, we have, I think next week, you know, my duration here will surpass the previous long duration for a single flight, crew member Mike Lopez-Alegria. And so a trip to Mars is going to be much longer. It's going to be, you know, maybe 6 months getting there, a long time on the surface, and then a similar amount of time coming back. So we need to better understand the effects of this environment on our physiology, on our bone mass, muscle mass, on our vision, the radiation effects on us on a genetic level. And the space station has incredible capability to do imaging, to collect data, the stuff we're going to need to know to make that trip. So, you know, that's what this flight is about, trying to understand the physical effects, but also the psychological effects of being up here for a long time. You know, not being able to go outside for a year is not necessarily the easiest thing I'm ever going to do, but it's you know, part of what we need to understand better if we are going to set foot on Mars someday, and we will. It's you know, it's just going to, you know, take us some learning and you know, some more experience to get there.
Do you use GPS up there? GPS technology? Can you see the global positioning satellites that are your neighbors up there?
Well, our attitude control system, how the space station is positioned, not only in space but over the Earth, does use GPS technology, GPS receivers. We aren't able to see those GPS satellites. Those are in a much higher orbit, and unfortunately, we don't have many great windows looking up. Most of our windows are scientific windows looking down at the Earth, so that we can study the Earth and. In the cupola, we do look, have a little bit of a view of the limb of the Earth, but we can't see those satellites.
What's the most amazing thing about the station, both of you, in a short answer? The thing that really is a testimony to humanity's ability to innovate?
Well, for me, you know, just getting to live and work up here, even in the short time that I've been here, to see this incredible laboratory that has been up here with people working, living and working in it since for almost 15 years now. And in a month it'll be, or just in a few weeks it'll be, we'll celebrate 15 years of folks living and working here for that entire time. And so the fact that we have this up here that has been built, built out while people have been living, working up here, and it continues to serve as a scientific platform for studies that are going to not only help us get further deeper into space, but also to help improve life on the ground, I think is an amazing thing, and it's an incredible thing to be a part of.
Yeah,
and
so
for you, Scott?
You know, for me, I think it's simply that we,
for you, Scott?
Yeah, so we, you know, we put this thing together while hurtling around the Earth at 17,500 miles an hour in a vacuum. in extremes of temperature in this radiation environment where, you know, astronauts and cosmonauts went outside and, you know, bolted these modules together, some of which were never connected on the ground. And the fact that we did this as an international partnership, you know, using different standards of engineering and, you know, how we measure things and, you know, how we do things is just a, you know, a testament, I think, to the ingenuity of, you know, us as a species.
Well, very, very impressive. Scott Kelly and Kjell Lindgren, thanks so much. This is WNYC. Thank you, station.
Our pleasure.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the WNYC radio portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from CNBC.
Station, this is CNBC. Do you hear me?
Yeah, we have you loud and clear. How do you hear us?
Hear you fine. Thank you, station. We're ready to go. And we're joined by Commander Scott Kelly and Dr. Kjell Lindgren. Guys, great to have you with us. Commander Kelly, first of all, to you, congratulations. You recently broke the record for the most time spent in space. And you and your brother, the former astronaut, Mark Kelly, have been studying the long-term impacts of humans in space. What are you finding so far? What are you concerned about longer term?
Yeah, so, you know, those studies between my brother and I look a lot at us on a at a genetic level. There's also some, you know, human performance, you know, with regards to our cognitive abilities that we're looking at. But mostly it's on a genetic level. And between imaging that we do on board and imaging that he does by going to hospitals on the ground and samples that we collect and then send to the ground, there's a lot of analysis going on right now of the data, and, you know, science is a very methodical process, and they'll collect all the data and then analyze it over time. So with regards to those studies, there's really not, you know, too much that I know right now, but hopefully what we do learn will be very important for our journey to Mars. You know, one of the challenges of going to Mars is the, you know, radiation environment that the crew members are going to be exposed to when they get away from the Earth. It's, you know, more than we see here. And what those effects will have on us at a genetic level with our DNA or RNA damage that occurs. And, you know, hopefully we'll learn some more about that and how to protect against it.
Let's get the medical perspective. Dr. Lindgren, what are you looking at, and what concerns would you have, I mean, when you're taking a look at more than 300 days in space?
Well, yeah, I have to agree with Scott. You know, this the International Space Station is serving as a tremendous platform for investigating a lot of these things that that we need to know before we make that trip. And, you know, I think the most concerning thing to me right now is that radiation environment. We really don't see the galactic cosmic radiation that we would experience on our way to Mars just because of the protective atmosphere and the magnetosphere that that Earth provides. And so a lot of these heavy particles can cause damage, and we really need to have a better understanding of how they're going to interact with tissue and what long-term effects they're going to have. And how we can protect against that. And it may be that we just need faster engines, a faster trip to get to Mars and back. There are a lot of other physiologic changes that occur in space, but we seem to have a pretty good grasp on those, the bone loss, the muscle weakening, and cardiovascular deconditioning. We have countermeasures for those right now, but having a platform like this to make those investigations is critically important.
You know, Commander Kelly, there are so many preconceptions about space by people like us here on Earth who aren't really educated about the subject, and there are a lot of movies out there about space from which we derive those preconceptions. I'm wondering, out of all the movies out there right now, out of all the movies that have been out there, which do you think is the most realistic about space?
Yeah, so, yeah, that's a tough question, kind of putting me on the spot a little bit. I'll tell you what I like about.
Which is your favorite?
I wouldn't say like, but what's accurate about some of them.
Which is your favorite?
You know, I thought Apollo 13 was a great movie because it portrayed the characters very well. I think, you know, the type of people we work with and the human relationships. Certainly the movie Gravity, although there was, a lot about it that, I didn't really ring true on a personal level. The space station and the Soyuz sure did look very realistic. I mean, we watched that on board, and it was almost kind of creepy seeing, the space station we're living in portrayed in such a vivid way. In the Martian movie, although some of the very little of the stuff, I would say, wasn't accurate, a lot of it was the science part of it and the technical aspects of the mission seemed very, very believable and very true.
We'll try and convey that to Matt Damon for you, Commander Kelly. You have a very strong presence on social media, and your photographs that you tweet out are gorgeous. How important is social media to your mission?
I certainly, enjoy taking the pictures and then sharing them with people. And, not only people that I know, a lot of people I know look at those pictures, and that's kind of where I'm able to share, this flight with friends and family, but also, the general public at large. And, I think it's important for us to engage the public in, any way that we can, because, this is their program, and it's... I take a lot of pictures, and they're pretty pictures of the Earth, and, I hope I'm not giving the impression that's all that's going on up here. But I know people do enjoy them, so I like to do that. But, we do a whole lot more than that, and, while I'm here, it's going to be 400 different scientific experiments going on throughout the year in all different kinds of disciplines, and, I hope the general public realizes that and realizes the importance of that as well.
I think most people will be watching this interview and they'll see you guys and they'll think that you're just sort of standing there or hanging out, but you're actually, of course, suspended. Can you guys flip for us?
Yeah, we're floating.
You sure are. Can you also drink for us? I mean, I think people would be sort of curious as to how that happens also in zero gravity.
So drinking regularly is fairly unspectacular. We have our drinks come in these, we basically get these little foil containers and... they can be filled with, powder for juice or coffee, and we fill them with water. And Scott's going to we just use the straw, but if you can let a little bit of that liquid out, and it is fun to play with these bubbles of water. Kind of like Pac-Man.
That is amazing. I thought you guys were going to have Tang in that pack. Thank you guys so much for making time for us. I know you've got a very busy schedule, Commander Kelly and Dr. Lindgren. Appreciate it.
Thank you for having us. It was great spending time with you.
Station, this is Houston ACR. Thank you. That concludes the event.
WNYC Radio and the CNBC station. We're now resuming operational audio communications.
Hey, copy that, Vivian. Hey, and that's so. Any answer to that question about that CO2 valve to removal? There's no label on those things in the back of that.